I'm sure by now you must have heard about Bitcoin. In today's video, we'll look at how Bitcoin works, the idea of digital scarcity, and why it is almost impossible to counterfeit Bitcoin, even though it's generally easy to make copies of most digital goods. By the end of this video, you'll have clear answers to all these questions and more. So, let's dive in. Bitcoin is a digital currency built using blockchain technology. It's fully decentralized, so it cannot be controlled by a single person, organization, or even a government. I covered the history and reasons behind its creation in a previous video. I'll leave a link to that in the description if you're interested. Bitcoin has a fairly small feature set when compared to other blockchains. From a user point of view, there are only two main aspects to it. Accounts, where you can store your bitcoins, and transactions to transfer bitcoin between accounts. I covered how accounts work in any blockchain in my previous video about how blockchains work, but here is a quick recap. To generate accounts, you need a wallet. A wallet can be a mobile app or a browser extension. In this case, it needs to be compatible with Bitcoin, as not every wallet supports Bitcoin, but a majority of them do. I will link to some popular wallets below. Each account in a wallet consists of a private key, which must be kept secret at all times, and a public address. To send bitcoins to someone, you will need their public address. At a high level, that's about everything you can do with Bitcoin. All of this assumes that there are already wallets with bitcoins in their accounts, but how did the first wallets get their bitcoins? To answer that, we'll have to look at how bitcoins are created. Like any other blockchain, bitcoin transactions are recorded in blocks. Each block has a finite size, and right now it's limited to 1 megabyte on Bitcoin. To accommodate the latest transactions, a new block is created about every 10 minutes. This happens irrespective of whether the previous block is full or not. Whoever creates the next block can reward themselves with newly created bitcoins. This is called the block reward. The first block on the Bitcoin ledger had only one transaction, which deposited 50 bitcoins in the account of Satoshi Nakamoto, the creator of Bitcoin, thus bringing the first bitcoins into existence out of thin air. The block reward is not constant. It started as 50 bitcoins per block when Bitcoin was launched in 2009. And it is cut in half after every 210,000 blocks. This is called a halving event. On average, a new block is created every 10 minutes. So, we'll have a halving event about every 4 years. The Bitcoin protocol is designed to have 32 halving events in total, after which the block reward will be set to zero. And no further Bitcoins are created. This will happen approximately by the year 2140. And by then, the total bitcoins ever created will be close to 21 million. So, if you keep hearing about that there will only be 21 million bitcoins ever, well, now you know where that number comes from. The current block reward is 6.25 bitcoins. And that's a high reward for creating a block. So, naturally, every node in the Bitcoin network competes with each other for a chance to create the next block. The winner is determined in a decentralized manner through a mechanism called proof of work. In order to create a block, the nodes must find a solution to a mathematical problem. This problem is designed using a cryptographic hash function. We already covered hash functions in our last video about how blockchains work, but here's a quick recap. A cryptographic hash function takes an input and produces an unpredictable, fixed-length output. Not random, just unpredictable. There are many such functions, but the one used by Bitcoin is called SHA-256. Now, let's look at Bitcoin's proof-of-work problem. We take a hash of the previous block, a hash of all transactions that we are putting in the current block, some metadata, and a random number referred as nonce. We combine this and pass it into the SHA-256 hash function. The output is passed into the hash function again, and the final result that comes out after all this must be smaller than a specific number referred to as target, If it's not smaller, you pick a different number for the nonce and try again. And again, until we find an output that is smaller than the target. Since the output is unpredictable, the only way to find a solution is by trying repeatedly with different nonces. So, there is definitely a bit of luck playing a part here, and the price is 3 bitcoins. I mentioned earlier that new blocks are created about every 10 minutes. The reality is, you can create a block as soon as you find a hash that is smaller than the target. However, the target is not the same for each block. It is adjusted using a parameter called difficulty. As difficulty rises, the target number becomes smaller, meaning we have to try more hashes before we can find a suitable solution. The opposite is also true. As difficulty is reduced, we find a solution by trying fewer hashes. The difficulty is adjusted every 2016 blocks, which is approximately every 2 weeks, so that the average time between each block remains 10 minutes. This is why we say a block is created about every 10 minutes. Sometimes it can be a block every 8 minutes and sometimes 14 minutes. As you can see, the solutions to the Bitcoin's math problem already exist. We just need to work really hard to find them. Similar to how we put a lot of effort to mine rare elements like gold that already exist. Hence, this process is referred to as mining, and the nodes that participate in this work are called miners. As a miner, your chances of finding a valid solution depends on how fast you can calculate these hashes, measured as hashes per second. Today, a flagship smartphone can do roughly 50 hashes per second. With a very high-end gaming PC, you can get around 200 million hashes per second. But all this pales in comparison to the ASICs used for Bitcoin mining these days. ASICs can perform about 100 trillion hashes per second. If you think that's a big number, then get this. Right now, it takes on average 60 quintillion hashes before you can find a solution. An astronomically large number of hashes to create just one block. Since all miners are competing with each other to find the next solution, it's entirely possible that occasionally, two different miners find the solution at about the same time. This leads to what's called a one-block fork. When two miners mint the next block at the same time and claim the reward. Generally, this resolves itself when the next block is built on top of either one of these two blocks. Two-block forks are also possible, but are much less likely. The network will eventually pick one branch over the other and finally reach consensus. To get there, we have to perform a block reorg. In a block reorg, miners should always pick the chain with the most amount of computational work put in, which is typically also the longest chain. Block reorg is a feature of Bitcoin and in general, any blockchain that uses proof-of-work consensus. When a block reorg happens, some transactions get discarded from the blockchain. For this reason, a transaction on the Bitcoin ledger is generally not considered as confirmed until a few blocks are mined on top of it. The protocol recommends 6 block confirmations, but this is not enforced by it. It's up to the parties involved in the transaction to decide how many block confirmations are required. Despite being completely open for anyone to join, or rather because of it, Bitcoin is the most secure ledger ever created. In the last 10 years, it processed over $10 trillion worth in Bitcoin without a single fraudulent transaction. Practically speaking, it's impossible to alter a transaction deep in the Bitcoin ledger. Let's take a quick example to see why that is. Say you bought a car with Bitcoin and the transaction now has 10 block confirmations. This just means 10 more blocks have been mined on top of the block that contains your transaction. If you alter this block and remove your transaction, the hash becomes invalid, so you have to mine this block again to find a new solution. This takes about 60 quintillion hashes at current difficulty. Since each block refers to the hash of the previous block, all the 10 blocks that come after this are also invalid. We know that the protocol always picks the longest chain. So, you now have to mine 12 blocks before someone else mines another block. that's a grand total of 720 quintillion hashes in under 10 minutes, which is an impossible task, even if you have access to all the supercomputers in the world. Needless to say, the Bitcoin ledger is extremely hard to tamper with. Almost everything we discussed so far are rules defined by the current Bitcoin protocol, and it is entirely possible to change the protocol and rewrite these rules. Say if you want to have 50 million Bitcoins as limit instead of 21 million. However, controversial changes such as this are almost impossible to get through because you need a consensus among all the network participants to actually implement them into the protocol. To give you an example, the Bitcoin community couldn't reach a consensus to increase the block size from 1 megabyte to 2 megabytes. Something so seemingly benign became a controversial topic. When differences like this arise, a small set of miners could actually adopt the new protocol, which is incompatible with the old one. This will lead to what's called a hard fork of the blockchain. There have been several hard forks of Bitcoin, but only a handful of them survived until today. This goes to show that even though it's very easy to make a clone of Bitcoin, it's extremely hard for the clones to gain significant traction or survive in the long run. With that, we're almost out of time. There are many more aspects to Bitcoin, but in the interest of keeping our videos short, I left them out as topics for future videos. Before you leave, don't forget to hit the like button. It helps a lot with the YouTube algorithms. And also, subscribe if you like to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching. My name is Praveen, and I'll see you again soon.